A young dancer needs more than great physical prowess to succeed, as former principal ballerina Deborah Bull explains now on BBC Two. From childhood onwards, it's as much about brain power.
I always do this before a show, but it's not a superstition. It helps stick my shoe to my foot.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your 2 minute call. 2 minutes, please. Thank you.
Quick bite of banana, then it's time to go. It can get a bit tense here in the wings, but coping with butterflies is just part of the job. And however nervous you feel, you can't afford to lose your head. Without it, your feet aren't going anywhere. In this programme, we're going to explore the wonders of the human brain, how it helps us to control and coordinate extraordinary movement, and how the mind sometimes can get in the way. Over my years as a professional dancer, I must have danced literally millions of steps in hundreds of different ballets. I've spent my life with a head full of footsteps, and now I finally have the chance to find out how my brain learnt to dance. How the steps got in, and how I get them out again.
How dancers do several things at once.
How the brain controls every single move we make, and how just thinking about movement sets our brains dancing. Our bodies are around two-thirds water, and I've always thought it's amazing that something so physical, something that can do this, or this, should be so much plain H2O. Even our bones are 10 to 15% water. The human brain, where all this movement starts, is even more watery, around 80%. A litre of space that's home to a million neurons. That's as many neurons as there are stars in the Milky Way. And somewhere, swimming around up there, are all the memories of all the steps I've ever danced. Deep in the centre, at the top of the spinal cord, is the brainstem. It controls all our automatic functions: breathing, blinking, and swallowing. And we're not even aware it's there. Just behind the brainstem is the beautiful cerebellum, dance central, because that's where balance and coordination are controlled. The third and largest part of the brain is the cerebrum, the conscious bit that allows us to perform complicated tasks like speaking, reading, or dancing. The wrinkly outer layer, the cortex, is the brain's command center. It's where all the messages from the body are received and all the brain's commands to the body are dispatched. So where in this mass of cells does a movement start? Let's dive in and take a closer look. Say I want to make a kick. I start with the thought, or the will, and that stimulates a part of the cortex up here that contains the recipe, all the ingredients to make it happen. Once this planning is complete, the signal is sent to another part of my cortex. And it's the motor cortex which gives the green light, sending the action signal out to my muscles. Pulsing from here to here, five times faster than the fastest Olympic sprinter, to deliver the perfect kick. But dancing isn't about a single perfect kick. It's about hundreds of individual muscle moves, all coordinated to produce a performance. To investigate how an experienced dancer learns new steps, I've asked choreographer Alita Collins to make a new dance for this programme. It'll be a performance that draws on my basic dance technique, but I've asked her not to make it too easy for me. Taking her cue from a raunchy piece of music, she's put me in high heels instead of on point. And boy, are some of the moves fast.
Let's just start doing a phrase, travelling this way. The phrase should be these wonderful big leg moments. Yum. One, a big kick that way. One. Take the hips around a circle and a hit there. Very nice. Well, when I first heard the music, Copeland's Burlesque, I just thought it would make a great piece. It was big, it was sassy, with elements of the stripper, elements of fun. But then what I wanted to work on was, how do you psych yourself up for that kind of dance?
You just want to bring that back. Paddle, paddle.
We wanted to take it through its stages, starting very small with the feet and with the technicians actually finding lights and clearing the space. And then in tandem, the two things building. So as they began to bring on the stairs, Deborah was undressing. 7, push 8.
I've come prepared with my package of basic ballet steps. Second nature after 30 years training.
First, second, third, fourth, fifth, and hundreds more besides. Unfortunately, choreographers like Alita tend not to use them. Instead, they challenge me to remember steps I've never done before. Movements from everyday life. Quotations from other dance styles. Things they just make up.
And yum! 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Dancers learn by doing. It's rough, it's wobbly, and it's peppered with failure. But it's the repeated failures that constitute learning.
2, 3. And hold!
For even the simplest movement to happen, thousands of nerve cells have to fire at the same time. When we repeat a movement, the same set of cells in the brain fire together, activating the same muscles in the same sequence. Every time they fire, the connections between them get stronger. Cells that fire together, wire together. Practice a new move often enough, and these connections create a mini-network, a muscle memory.
It's a yum, boom.
So these early fumbling attempts aren't wasted. They're the visible effects of my brain working out the most efficient and direct method to get my muscles to move in a new way. Experiments have shown that it can take up to 180 repetitions for a new muscle memory to stick. Which is why, for every hour you see on the stage, there are around 20 spent in a studio like this. In Alita's rehearsal, my brain was recombining familiar movements in a new way, writing new words out of an existing alphabet. But like any child learning to write, I first of all had to learn my ABC. We have the maximum number of brain cells when we're around 7 years old. From that point on, the numbers start to go down. We can lose brain cells at the astonishing rate of 100,000 every day. This doesn't mean we're any less intelligent as the years go by, but it does help to explain why we find it increasingly difficult to learn. And our flexibility starts to wane once we're past our teens. You can learn to dance at any age. It's good for you, and it'll help keep you fit. But if you really want to be a ballet dancer, you have to start young. My earliest dance memories are rooted in the place where I grew up in the 1970s, Skegness on the east coast of England. Here, down Chip Shop Alley, as everybody calls the High Street, above an amusement arcade, was the Janice Sutton School of Dance.
Wow.
Times have changed, but the slot machines are still raking it in. Janice hasn't been back here since she moved to new premises 20 years ago, and it's 30 years since my mother brought me and my two sisters here for our first dance lesson.
But this isn't the staircase, because it was a stone staircase.
That's right. It's a long time ago, Deborah. Remember? Here we go. I can remember your mum bringing you through here. And this is where you stood, Deborah. Come over here. You stood here, and I can remember the three girls, Mrs. Bull, bringing them in. She said, there you are. I brought you three girls. They all want to dance. And I brought them to you, and I stood here. First thing she did for me, I said, right, let me see if you can stretch your foot like that. And instantly, the strength and everything was there. Wow.
I can't believe it.
Once a week, I attended Janice's class with a dozen other little girls. No boys in those days. What I remember most is how much fun we had. We'd skip, we'd hop, and we'd dance around in circles.
So while my seven-year-old brain was getting to grips with regular human movement, walking, riding a bicycle, or catching a ball, it was also mastering the basic alphabet, which would set me up as a ballet dancer.
Step.
closed step. So can we do a nice point? Put your heel down. Now point it and close in first position. Now what shape are we going to make when we do a demi-plie? Put your nose. A diamond, that's right. We've got to make a big diamond. And every time we do these demi-plies, each one's going to get better, isn't it? Ready? One, and stretch.
They have to learn the technical side of it. It has to be done over and over again so that the little ones realise that they will improve, and they do improve.
Point.
Learning's been quite difficult to study in a way because people have spent a lot of time and come up with the conclusion that practice makes perfect, which we sort of knew before.
Now, put your feet in first position.
It turns out that there are probably two specific elements to learning. The first one is, if you like, a planning process. So if the step involves moving the foot to a new position, the dancer will need to learn the set of commands that will get their foot to just that position.
We're going to see who's really clever.
Then there's a second step. Once you've decided what the commands the brain needs to send to which set of muscles and at what time, you then need to make sure that precisely those commands are sent and that they do move the foot in precisely the correct way.
Sit up nice and straight, that's it. Can we have one good one and one naughty one? Who can do a good one and a naughty one?
These are two separate processes, but in fact they work together. When a child is learning, they will be learning both to plan the commands better, but then they'll also be learning, when their foot's moving, to update the commands more precisely, more rapidly, and more accurately.
It's practice, isn't it? The more times we do it, the better we get.
So while I was repeating Janice's favourite exercise, good toes, naughty toes, I was reinforcing my learning and starting to listen to feedback from my body. I was developing the sixth sense that we use to control movement. But there's nothing paranormal about this sense. We all have it. It's just that few of us realise it actually exists. It's only when you lose it, you start to realise how important it is. It's called proprioception.
Proprioception, never even heard of it. So, you know, how I lost it, I don't know. The complete, well, hey, what's that? Very scary stuff. I was working in Jersey about 30 years ago as a butcher. Got what I thought was flu, and gradually got weaker and weaker and weaker, and was eventually taken into hospital. And woke up the following morning with no ability to control movement. I still had movement, and I could move an arm and I could move a leg, but I had no very fine control over that. The consequences were that I couldn't control my body without looking at what was happening. It wasn't for some time that I found that key, that I had to associate vision with picking up feedback.
Ian Waterman is one of fewer than 15 people in the world who have no proprioception. He has no sense of touch below the neck, and he's unable to sense where his limbs are or how they're moving. With the help of neurophysiologist Jonathan Cole, he's become the only sufferer from this rare condition to regain his mobility.
Ian has lost this odd thing called proprioception, which is the sensation of movement and position sense. So that if he doesn't look at an arm, he doesn't know where it is.
When you stand and when you dance, you don't necessarily think about where exactly am I in time and space. I have to think about all the processes that go on behind that, developing the movement. Am I safe? Am I in the right position?
And then slowly he realised that if he looked at a moving part and then thought and willed it to move, he could control that movement.
It took me an awful long time to learn just to stand. And I even say that today, one of the toughest things that I have to do is to stand perfectly still. It was very, very difficult to learn the concept that if you put an arm out, you'd go that way. That's what things do. So I had to lean slightly that way. And they tried to use mirrors, which you use as a dancing feel. And I tried that, but I just couldn't work it all together quickly enough in my head. So I very quickly gave up the mirrors and just concentrated on looking down, which is why I walk in the way that I do, which is inclined forward and looking down, so I can catch my whole body, so I can monitor and control and look at what's happening.
You're literally dependent on being able to see your foot so that you know it's done the right thing.
When you're walking down the road, you don't think about every step that you're taking. I do, otherwise I lose touch with where things are. I remember walking over the Millennium Bridge earlier. I had to stop and admire the view rather than just sort of like glance up as I was walking along, because to have glanced up would have taken the feedback that I require away.
So if you close your eyes?
If I was to close my eyes, I'd stay in this position. That's quite an easy thing to do, but freeze certain muscles and freeze into a posture. But if we go back the 25 years or so when I was first disabled, if I was to close my eyes for more than a few seconds, I'd fall over. I hadn't learned these strategies of freezing the tummy muscles.
I think I'm understanding what you physically have to go through, but what is the neurological explanation for what Ian's going through?
There are peripheral nerves that go to the skin, go to the muscles, go to the joints. And some of those are movement nerves, so when they fire, bits of you move, and some are sensation nerves. In Ian, he had an infection, and he raised an antibody which actually attacked the nerve cells and wiped them out. Just the sensory nerves conveying touch, movement and position sense.
So you can send messages to your body in exactly the same way as me,
yeah.
But you don't get the message back which tells you what you've done.
Yeah, I don't get the acknowledgement saying, yeah, that's right, you got it right, and I now move on to the next stage.
After 4 years with Janice Sutton, I moved away from home, aged 11, to start my professional training here at the Royal Ballet School in West London. Ballet was no longer something I did on Saturday afternoons. Every morning started at the bar, and every day was filled with classes. One minute it was dancing, the next it could be French, history, or science. Our exercises were repeated over and over, day in, day out, until the basic technique of ballet became second nature.
One striking difference between the movements of an expert adult ballet dancer and a child who's just learning is in smoothness. The movements of an adult are elegant, smooth, graceful. The movements of the child can be intermittent, jerky, a little bit erratic. And this smoothness is actually provided by the way the brain controls their action. When you're trying to control your own body, just like when you're trying to control any kind of external machine, delays are a big problem. You want your commands to be obeyed instantaneously. When a child is learning to make a movement, it will send the command from the brain to the muscles, and it will use feedback to monitor whether the muscles have really done what they're supposed to or not. But of course, it takes time for those sensory signals to get back from the foot and from the eyes, for the child to realize whether this movement is going wrong or succeeding, and then to adjust the movement by issuing a new motor command. So feedback pathways tend to be rather slow. And if you're always relying on feedback to adjust your movement will always be stopping and starting. It'll be jerky, it will be erratic. Now, adults, and particularly adult experts, seem to rely rather less on feedback than learners and children do. And the reason for this seems to be that they can predict how their foot is going to move when they send a command. They can estimate exactly how the foot is going to respond to their own instructions. This means they don't need to spend so much time waiting for feedback information to come back to their brain. This trick of prediction, predicting the consequences of our own actions, is absolutely fundamental to motor learning.
5, 6, 7, 8, 1. After 10 years of schooling, I thought I knew how to dance. Then I joined the corps de ballet and discovered that all my training was just a starting point. Choreographers began to demand new and ever more complicated moves, near impossible coordination of head, arms and legs. Akram Khan trained in the North Indian art of Kathak dance, where each limb has to move precisely in its own independent sequence.
I started training from a very early age, from the age of 7. It's very demanding, but it's needed. It was a training that happens through repetition. It's like a layer, put layer over layer. So the first thing you're taught is speak the rhythms. And then you start to do the footwork. So you understand the pattern because you've been able to speak it. And then once you learn that subconsciously, then you start to put the handwork. Once it becomes subconscious, you can play with different patterns because you know exactly where you are within the linear line, but you're going away from it and then you're coming back to it. So actually what you're doing is doing two things at once.
Our brains don't like our limbs to act independently. Moving them in different patterns and at different speeds means creating yet another mini network of muscle memories. So through repetition, the dancer's brain chunks together several things at once. Instead of commanding head, arms and legs separately, it commands them all together as a package deal.
It's my final rehearsal with Alita Collins and I'm just about dancing our little number. Up to speed.
You don't get heels like this on your ballet shoes.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Take it very easy the first time.
Yeah.
We haven't really done very much in there.
The faster you move, the less accurate the movement becomes. All physical skills involve this trade-off between speed and precision. The new muscle memories I'm creating during these rehearsals allow me to be fast and accurate. My performance is becoming smoother, more controlled, and fingers crossed, more impressive. But what's changing inside my brain? As the choreography becomes second nature, it moves from my conscious brain into the area that deals with balance, coordination, and complex physical skills, the cerebellum.
Which, when you do that slowly, it's perfect. It's that feeling.
It's like coordination. Nightmare, this is.
That's much nicer.
Okay.
To the knee, yes. Smashing.
Yeah.
Good.
Great.
Very nice.
Our brains are adept at doing several things at once, dealing with the familiar, like getting home after a day at work, making all sorts of everyday decisions. No, later. Or coping with the unexpected. Steering me home and negotiating street performers, my brain is also hard at work. I'm thinking about what's for dinner, but my cerebellum is still on full alert, perfecting the moves I learnt earlier with Alita. And it'll go on doing that while I travel home, while I'm cooking, even while I'm watching television. I might have stopped thinking about the rehearsal, but my brain hasn't. It's laying down those moves permanently, even now. It's like making a jelly. You can stir it as much as you like, but at some point you have to set it aside and allow it to set. Jelly's set in about 60 minutes. This process will go on for the next 5 hours. The bad news is that if you have to learn a second package of movement within those 5 hours, your brain will try to overwrite the first. Yet dancers can be learning 4 or 5 different ballets in a single day. It's not the way our brains like to work.
Whilst making this programme, I've faced exactly that dilemma. Even as I've been learning burlesque with Alita, I've also been rehearsing a part I first danced in the corps de ballet as a teenager, Kenneth Macmillan's Concerto. We're going to use Concerto to discover what happens in dancers' brains when we dance, and even when we just think about dancing. To do that, we're going to use an fMRI brain scanner.
With fMRI, or functional magnetic resonance imaging, what we're really doing is getting an image of the activity inside your brain when you're watching a video or performing a movement. When we put somebody inside the brain scanner, What we do is we give them prism glasses. So if we have a projector screen at the end of the scanner bed, we can play people video images. What we're actually measuring with fMRI is the blood flow change inside your brain. It's like a muscle, it needs oxygen. And the blood flow brings that oxygen to those bits of your brain that are working very hard, and that's what we're actually measuring the signal from.
Two short film clips have been prepared, a performance of Shostakovich's music and another that adds Kenneth MacMillan's choreography. Both clips are played several times over, whilst I lie perfectly still. The question is, which bits of my brain are activated when my mind is on dancing?
What we do is we take the two images of watching the dance and watching the orchestra, subtract one from the other, and actually demonstrate that area in Deborah's brain that's uniquely activated when she watches dance.
So this is me watching concerto on the video screen.
Yeah, that's right. And from that, we've subtracted you just watching the orchestra because all the elements were the same between the two. And now we're getting into the region where we're interested, and it's this centre part here, basically.
And this is the premotor and the motor cortex.
That's right, right, yeah. We zoom up a little bit, we click on a slide. And so I know that this is motor cortex here, this premotor area.
These areas in the premotor cortex feed into motor cortex. They're actually sort of the pre-stage, the planning stage of movement. The fact that they can be activated purely by a visual input does make sense because that's how we learn to move. We watch other people's movements and that's how we can plan and generate our own movements.
The only thing that's specific is you watching you dance.
So red areas are showing the activation.
And so red shows activation and yellow shows really highly significant activation.
Okay. When we perform the analysis, what we actually see is that Deborah's brain uniquely activates when she watches dance in these premotor areas. She's clearly associating making that movement. She can't possibly dance inside of there. And we know from looking at her brain activation, she doesn't move because motor cortex itself isn't activated. But this area that plans what she would be doing, could she move? We're seeing that area uniquely activated.
Next, they asked me to simply imagine the steps, to visualise dancing concerto in my head.
Even in the absence of any visual input, she can merely close her eyes and imagine making those movements, and she will still activate this same area of premotor cortex.
So my brain's planning to do the movement, even though it knows my body's got no chance of doing
Absolutely.
It.
As far as the brain's concerned, imagined movements are almost the same as actual movements, just without the muscle contraction. And this is one of the great secrets of expert performers, used by dancers, actors and athletes. Rehearsing in your head. Some people call it imaging, others visualization. It allows you to strengthen the neural pathways that will produce the step, make them more accurate, faster, smoother, without stressing the body, and wherever you are, whatever you're doing. Perhaps it's no wonder I do my best dancing in my dreams. Actors learn their parts from scripts, and musicians even get to look at the score during performance, but dancers have no choice. We have to work from memory. Ballets are passed on by the choreographer, or the company teachers, or sometimes by the person who originally danced the part. Anthony Dowell is arguably the greatest male dancer this country has ever produced. The ballet Four Schumann Pieces was created for him in the 1970s, and he last danced it 20 years ago. We're going to find out how much he can remember as he passes it on to Royal Ballet principal Jonathan Cope. They're joined by dance notator Jackie Hollander, who attended the original rehearsals to write down the steps.
I remember I had to wait here, I think with the hands clasped,
yep,
I think.
Absolutely.
And then the lifts went behind
that's
me.
That's right, that's
and
right.
And then on a certain note, I think I had to let them and look, yes?
That's it, that's right, that's right.
But, and then, and
you're turning the wrong way, Anthony. The whole thing was done for you to turn to the left. So you're right.
So how am I going to be exposed for not remembering now? So after here, I don't know what happened.
Maybe it would help. Would you, it might be easier if you do it with the music, because I'm sure that'll...
Yeah. There's a look here. That's the look. And here we go. Oh, I see. Okay. Not too high, those, really. Go. Oh gosh. No,
arabesque.
Blank there.
So that's it.
Was there that?
Yes, so both hands there as you go to arabesque. Then you stepped up, then and then.
Not the arabesque.
No,
ten. No. Oh, double toe. Oh God. No wonder I blocked that out.
It is interesting how it seems to build, and the first time you might forget something, and then when you use second time, a little bit extra comes.
I bet you if you saw it just once.
Saw it.
Just once.
Yes,
you
maybe.
You could, it's just that glimmer of the whole thing.
Yes,
and suddenly
yes, maybe.
You'd see the steps.
Mm.
With the notation and Anthony's memory both reaching their limits, it's lucky Jackie has found a video in the archive.
Let's see this. One, two, three.
That's what's so interesting, is when you do ballets after a long time, your body does the outline things, but it's the little, which way did I turn and where, those things that tend to go.
Well, I've got what you did, but putting it onto my body is another thing. One, two, three.
Oh. Well, no, whoops. Plie as much as possible so we get that feeling. Like you've got a book on your
book
head.
Book on head.
Groucho Marx. Tita, tita. Right, right.
Every run-through now recalls new details for Anthony, and Jonathan is beginning to lay down his own pattern of memories for four Schumann pieces.
Here I am, back inside my brain. But it's no use me looking around for an area labelled memory. There's no attic up here stuffed with old ballet memories. I store them all over the place. Some bits are close to hand because they're needed now. Others are tucked away. Ready if need arises. It's how a busy ballet company stores its costumes.
They call it the wardrobe, but that makes it sound like it's all contained in one place.
Right here, next to my place in the dressing room, is a rack with all the costumes I'm wearing in the short term. Concerto. This dress I was wearing only last week, and this one, well, this is for Alita's number. Up here, in the running wardrobe, they keep all the costumes in use this season. Don Quixote, Giselle, Romeo and Juliet, Swan Lake. Safely stored out of harm's way, but it doesn't take long to pull them out when they're needed.
Costumes that aren't being used this season are put into long-term storage. There are hundreds of them from every ballet I've ever danced. They may be hidden away, but it only takes a phone call to get them back.
The Royal Ballet's costume department call these the Bibles. These files contain all the information they need to recreate the costumes for any ballet in the repertoire. And this is the one for Concerto. Like the Royal Ballet's costumes, my dance memories aren't all stored in the same place. They're scattered around various zones of my brain, and each one has a different trigger to bring it back. And I don't store each muscle instruction for every step. Contract psoas, contract rectus femoris. I store a representation of the step, like this costume.
It represents the role of Odette in Swan Lake.
It's not the role itself.
Because our movement memories are stored as symbolic representations, there's no specification for speed or size of action. This gives the brain a choice. Take my signature. I can sign my name neatly and precisely, or I can scrawl it large. Both use the same representation in my head.
Which is why my brain can command a tiny assemblée or a massive one down the corridor. So in my brain, there are representations of the 100 or so ballets I've danced during my 20-odd years as a professional dancer. Some I see so clearly, I could run them in my head. Others are mere sketches, the odd jump or a turn. But they're all there somewhere. And the simplest of triggers, hearing a snippet of the music, can be enough to bring them flooding back. Solos I've danced more times than I can count. Like this one from Swan Lake. Don't need any kind of trigger to set them free. The steps are so automatic that I can be talking to you about feats of memory while I'm dancing Swan Lake from somewhere in the recesses of my mind. Of course, you only get to this stage after years of rehearsals. When you first learn a solo, you have to think about every single step just to make it happen. And then there's a stage where you start to associate cues with the movement. So you hear the music and it flows. And then there's a third stage where you don't have to think at all. It's completely automatic. You can dance it on autopilot.
Seen quite so many controls, Jane. What do they all do?
They're kind of grouped together, really. First, we have our main flying controls. For example, this wheel, a bit similar to a steering wheel in the car. This turns us left and right. These are the power levers. Lots of different engine systems above us. This is the panel that we use to tell the autopilot what to do next.
So this is the famous autopilot?
This is the famous autopilot with the autopilot on-off switches.
And this for ordering coffee?
And that for ordering coffee, yes. The autopilot basically knows how to fly the aeroplane, so we then have to tell it where we want it to go. So we program the details of our flight.
Fantastic. So you're just going to sit here now with your arms folded?
Correct.
I'll just wipe my palms. So there's the airport, Jenny. You're going for a no-hands landing.
Absolutely. The autopilot's flying the aeroplane. I'm monitoring what it's doing and I'm ready, obviously, to take controls. Except we have a problem here. We have a wind shear warning here, which means I've got to take the autopilot out. Wind shear is a change in direction and strength of the wind that can bring the aircraft dangerously close to the ground. So I've put us into a climb. We're climbing away. We're clear of the shear now, so we can come back for another landing.
Shall I reassure the passengers? So autopilot relieves the real pilot of the chores involved in flying. But boy, does she snap to attention at the first sign of trouble. Which is pretty much what goes on in my head when I dance Swan Lake. After all those years, the steps are so familiar that my cerebral cortex can engage autopilot and I can think about something else. All my conscious brain needs to do is keep an eye out for the unexpected.
It could be a wrong note from the orchestra. A mobile phone in the audience. Or something unwelcome from the deepest recesses of the mind. About 10 years ago, I had a really bad injury, my right ankle. And when I finally got back on the stage, it was in a big role, a role which was new to me. So I was under a lot of stress. I felt like I was being watched. Not so much by the management, more by the other dancers in the company. And however hard I worked, I still felt under-rehearsed. And then I realized I was panicking about one step, just one step which my foot wasn't strong enough to handle. It's a step I've never liked. It's all on one leg, which happened, of course, to be the injured one. And although I could have pulled out, well, I just wanted to get back to work. So I did it. It started off quite well. To be honest, I thought I was rather good. But as I got into position for that dreaded step, it was like a self-destruct mechanism came into play. I just knew it was going to fail. The music rolled up to the starting point, and my world reduced to a single spot with me in it. Everything went dark. I couldn't really see anything. And the worst thing was the connection between my brain and my feet was totally gone. I couldn't get any messages through, and I wasn't getting any information back. So, to be honest, I don't even know if I did the step at all. It was horrible. It was like wading through glue in the dark. 10 seconds of panic in an entire career. I can't imagine what living with stage fright must be like.
In 1999, Tammy Sear won the British Ladies Figure Skating Championship. The following year, an injury triggered an attack of performance anxiety that shattered her career. In order to rebuild her confidence, and hoping to regain her place in the British team, she's entered a competition in Milton Keynes.
The nerves start to kick in when you do your makeup and hair, because you know that it's like the final preparation before you get to the ice rink. And if you're not focused the minute you step on the ice, then you might as well get off, really. You've really got to be ready from the moment you step on. I dread this. Every day I have to strap my foot, and it's just such a palaver. I basically broke it doing an element while I was training in America. It's never been fully recovered. And again, I'm not sure whether it is now psychological with the strapping that I'm worried every time I jump that I will go over. So strapping it helps me to do the jump. I have no confidence in this ankle whatsoever. Most people would have actually given up on their sport by now, and not put themselves through the pain and pressure of not knowing whether it's going to go again. I've got an hour and a quarter now before my competition starts. So I'm now beginning to think, okay, focus, it's time to work, it's time to go and do your job. It's time to get a bit more serious. I had this little voice in the back of my head saying, you can't do it. You've done it once, you've broken your ankle once, what if you do it again? I just couldn't get rid of that voice, and then it went even further into more of my skating, and you start to put yourself down, and every competition you go into, you're like, I just can't do it, I'm not ready. So you try and make excuses for the hidden agenda, which is deep down thinking that you're no good anymore, really. This competition, it's a very small one. There'll be like less than 10 people, and it's something that I have to do. I'm not 100% ready for it. I'm still in my practice season. So it was just, okay, whatever happens, happens. Just beginning to rush a little bit, because I've got about 40 minutes, so not much time now, really. I need to warm my body up. Welcome to the mess of our changing room.
To overcome her anxiety, Tammy images her routine to the music, visualising each element performed to perfection.
I've been visualising with my injury to imagine that it's actually healing itself. When I'm very nervous, I see myself falling horrendously in my visualisation. Just beginning to panic a bit because I feel like I'm running out of time to warm up, so. But I always, it's the same every competition. It's agonising, really, because you know you can do it and your body's strong again, but there's just something that stops you. It's getting into the zone. It's like walking through a tunnel and people are throwing bricks at you almost, that they just bounce off you, and you're so focused, you know where you're going, you know what you're going to do. A bit of a disaster. I didn't meet any of my goals that I set myself to do. I would have liked to have done at least one jump and rotated some of the others that I messed up. But my mind was in the right place, but my timing was really off, which sort of surprised me a bit. And because that surprised me, I think I kind of started to rush my elements instead of taking my time.
3.5.
Although I won, it wasn't a win that I'm happy about. It wasn't something that I skated my best for, and it's like, oh, I'm kind of frustrated that I have to go out there and get my medal because I don't feel like I deserve it.
Over the last couple of months, Tammy has boosted her confidence with several more wins. Visualizing success seems to lead to success. Hestri Kluter took silver in the women's high jump at the Sydney Olympics. The New Zealand rugby squad start every fixture with their haka. Ballet dancers image when they mark steps with their hands and feet. Before a performance, it's a good idea to warm up your brain as well as your muscles. Seems like ages since I was here in the opera house rehearsing with Alita. In my high heels. But it's showtime, so come on, brain, strut your stuff. Time to pull together all those bits which make up the dance from their various homes around my head. So how did it start? One, two...
returns next Saturday night at the slightly later time of 7:25 here on BBC Two.